Hello everyone, I'm Sushmita Sarkar. I welcome you all in today's lecture. That's the last lecture in module 2 that we are going to talk about today, switching transients due to utility capacitors. Fine. So in this, as last class, last lecture, you have already seen that we have talked about how the high power frequencies, create so much of problems and what are the solutions for such kind of high frequency current, surge currents. We have seen it, and I told you the transients or voltages which are happening in the low or medium level due to the transient switching, we will be covering in today's lecture. Fine. So here we will be seeing it. We will basically studying about the dealing and problems related to capacitor switching transients at the utility end. And we will also be seeing the importance of the switching times and the different methods of, just to see that how these transients can be suppressed. So for that reason, we will be studying two different methods, that is a pre-insertion of resistors, and we are going to see the synchronous closing. That is a synchronous closing circuit breakers, basically they are, and how these two methods will help in to reduce such kind of transients into the system. Fine. So, and also we will see the importance of the location of these capacitors at the utility end or at the customer's end. Fine. So to start with this today's lecture, we have a basic thing to understand that this capacitor switching is very normal into the system, and it's a very serious issue, but it's not a thing that's not as damaging as in case of your high power frequency surges, but definitely these are very commonly seen, and you can see that as per the IEEE guidelines, this utility capacitor bank switching transients is a really an issue that exists in really every electrical system. So these capacitor banks has long been accepted as a necessary steps for while designing. You we should keep it in mind that these surges are going to affect the certain equipments into the system. Fine. So these capacitor switching is considered a normal operation for a utility system. So as I told you, that's not a very serious issue, but this is a very common issue which need to be tackled. Fine. So they are largely can be seen in the utility equipment end. So what we see is that when we talk about the surge arresters, and especially when we talk about the traditional surge arresters, they are not going to use so much at this particular level transient surges. Fine. So we need to have certain solutions, because those kind of SPDs we cannot use for these kind of surges. So we need to have a separate solutions to tackle with such kind of surges. Fine. So these low level kind of surges can be magnified at the customer end, or it can be done also at the utility end. So what happens, as you can see over here, that in the customer facility, if the customer has low voltage power factor correction capacitors, or can result in unwanted tripping of the power electronic devices, fine, such as your VSDs, which are very susceptible to changes in power quality. So we need to take care that due to certain steps or due to certain procedures, the unwanted loads, the unwanted tripping should not happen in the system. Fine. So the question comes, how utilities can deal with such kind of problems, which is related to a capacitor switching. So as we know, this is very common, but this is not very dangerous or effective to the equipment, but these are need to take care, because if you are not taking care of such kind of surges, these some unwanted trippings may happen, especially for the very sensitive loads. Fine. So we have to need to take when we come about the switching times. So if we are, based on the historical data, if we are aware about at what time the switchings will take place. So, certain industries can take in advance certain steps to go about it. Fine. So what does it say? The capacitor switching transients are very common and usually not damaging. Fine. So however, this the timing of switching may be unfortunate for some sensitive industrial loads, because initial stages when it's happening, and if you have an idea that this kind at this particular time transient will happen, so you can have some protective devices to limit that surges. Fine. So that is what we are telling, the importance of the switching times. So for an example, if the load peaks up the same time each day, so you know we have a certain graph. We say at this particular time in 24 hours the load goes to so high, and there may be a certain times where you are using and injecting the reactors, or you are the switching of the capacitors are taking place into the system. So if the time the utility may decide, if the time is known, then the utility may decide to switch the capacitors coincident with the load increase. So if you have an idea, this is the point of the day when the load is going to increase, so you can match with that particular time while switching on your capacitors, right? So this will help a lot to understand what is actually happening and how to tackle with such kind of surges. So there have been several cases where these coincides with the beginning of a work shift, and the resulting transient causes several ASDs, just to trip and just to shut down the whole process. So if you have a certain data which can help you to find out that this is the time of the load is going to increase, so you can just turn on the capacitors at that particular moment. So one simple and inexpensive solution. So, a very simple solution. It's not, it's very cost effective. It is to determine when the switching is going to take place. Fine. So determine if there is a switching time that might be more acceptable. So if the switching time is known, if the load increase timing is known, so a lot of tripping off or shutting down of the industries can be avoided. Fine. So now next we are going to see is what are the factors or what are the things which can added with the system, and if we added those particular things or to avoid these kind of transients. So what are those things? So we can say a pre-insertion resistors. So the pre-insertion resistor is which will limit your high, because the main problem is when these kind of surges will happen, the first peak is very, very important to be controlled. So if you have to control that peak value, that can be done with the help of the resistor. So that is what it's talking about, the pre-insertion of a resistor. So you can see how the pre-insertion of resistors look like. Fine, so it's look like a huge a bank. Fine, so here what they do, they can reduce the capacitor switching transients considerably. So basically this pre-insertion resistors are going to a slide, they will be in a sliding mode. I will show you in the later slides that how when they peak will happen, immediately the surges takes place. The first peak which will happen, it will be immediately will be controlled by, it cannot be eliminated, but it can be very well controlled by these sort of pre-insertion resistors. Fine, so the first peak of the transient is usually the most damaging. Fine, so the idea is to insert a resistor into the circuit briefly so that first peak is damped significantly. So you are able to control the first peak and bring it to a certain level. So this is an old technology, but still quite effective. Fine. So now here you can see one figure. So where it shows that you are connected with the load and you have the contacts, sliding contacts, and these are showing your, damping resistors. So this damping resistors, so here are your damping resistors, you can see it. So they will be in contact with your capacitors and the load when these kind of surges are taking place. Fine, so figure shows one example of a capacitor switch with pre-insertion resistors to reduce the transients. The pre-insertion is accomplished by the movable contact. So as I told you, so they are being, it's not that all the time they are in touch with your capacitors. So they will be in, they have been inserted into the system with the help of the movable contacts. So you can see that these movable contacts sliding past the resistor contacts first before mating with the main contacts. So this results in a pre-insertion time of approximately, so this takes around approximately 1/4 of the cycle. Fine, that holds good for a 60 Hertz. So the effectiveness of the resistors is depend on, obviously, the resistors which you are using as a pre-insertion resistor into your system, it mainly depends on the size of the capacitor you are using and based on the short circuit current value at the point of capacitor location. Fine, so these are the factors which depends on the value of your pre-insertion resistor. So here's one simple example. When you look into this table, you know, when you look into this table, this shows you a peak transient overvoltage due to capacitor switching with and without pre-insertion resistor. So this is your pre-insertion resistor. So you can see when the this kind of transients are taking place due to the capacitor switching, the voltage is jumping from 1 per unit to 1.95 per unit. So you will be able to control these kind of hike by the help of these resistors, which are having a, so this is a certain one example which has been taken where you are using a 6.4 ohm resistor. Fine, so this is a 6.4 ohm resistor. When you insert a 6.4 ohm resistor, the peak value can be reduced to 1.55. So you can see the significant decrease in your peak value with the different sizes of capacitor, fine? So there's a different, the different size of the capacitors will affect in decrease in your value of peak value of your voltage. So fine, so the table shows an expected maximum transient overvoltages upon energizing of various conditions, both with and without capacitors, without resistors. So now these are the maximum values are expected. So on an average, we see that typically, you know, without resistors, without a resistor, your typically value, which will go as high as 1.3 to 1.4 per unit. And with capacitor, you can limit that up to 1.1 to 1.2 per unit. Fine. So that is the effectiveness of the pre-insertion resistor. So we cannot avoid or eliminate complete surge, but we can restrict it to certain reduced value. Fine. Now these switches with pre-insertion reactors have also been developed. So it's not only with the resistors. So you can also have pre-insertion reactors, which are also developed in recent times. So the inductor is helpful in limiting the high frequency components of the transients. So now what will happen is in this kind of designs, the reactors are intentionally built with a high resistance so that appear loosey to the energization transients. Fine, so you are, these reactors will also have their resistance, pre-insertion resistance, what it is doing. So the quality of the pre-insertion resistor will also be implemented in this kind of reactors. So it will help you to control the high frequency components of the transients. So this helps the transient damp out quickly. Fine, so that is the main logic when you include a pre-insertion reactors. Fine, so pre-insertion resistor will help you to eliminate or will help you to reduce the peak value, but the pre-insertion reactor will help you to eliminate the high frequency components of the transients, as well as it will help you to damp out the transients as quickly as possible. Fine, then comes to the second method. So first method we have seen just now, the second methods we come up to, that is your synchronous closing. So synchronous closing is basically, this is another strategical tools where you reduce the transients on capacitor switching by using such kind of breakers. So these are basically called as synchronous closing breaker circuits. So fine, these are relatively a much more new technology compared to your pre-insertion resistors. So here, what they do exactly, what we are going to do in case of synchronous closing circuit breakers. So here we utilized a controlled switching technique. Okay, so where you minimize or eliminate the switching transients by energizing the capacitor at the same point when the voltage across the circuit breaker contact is zero. So basically you are trying to close at the same point when the circuit breaker contacts is the voltage across your circuit breaker contacts are zero. So that is the point, fine? That is the point when you are able to do it, you can reduce or eliminate the maximum point of the surges. So to accomplish this, it is very important that pre-striking should not occur, So when you close the switch at the time when the circuit breaker, when the voltage across the circuit breaker is zero, fine, and you, that time has to be matched with your energization time of the capacitor. And when you do that, the pre-striking should not take place. Fine, so that has to be taken care. And in order to avoid that pre-striking, the dielectric strength of the gap between the circuit breaker contacts must exceed the rate of the system voltage damage. Fine. So you need to take care of this last line, which we are talking over here is, that is you're called as to avoid this particular concept is also called as, you know, the RDDS method. So here what happened, you are, you know, you're basically, you're looking at the rate of the decay of dielectric, you know, the strength. So basically you are looking at the rate of the decay of the dielectric strength, and that's what we call over here. It's also, it's known as, this particular method is also known as RDDS, fine. So I hope it's understood. So what is basically a synchronous closing? So you know that your capacitor switching, when you are energizing your capacitors, that point should match with your voltage across your circuit breakers. At that point, the voltage across your circuit breaker should be zero. But while doing so, we should keep it in mind, the pre-striking should not take place. And in order to avoid the pre-striking, the dielectric strength of the gap between the circuit breakers contacts must exceed the rate of the system voltage. Fine, so now here you can see that this is a synchronous closing breaker. So it is an figure, fine, which is taken from an ABB. So you can see there are three poles of these breakers. So figure shows one example of a circuit breaker designed for this purpose. This breaker would normally be applied on the utility subtransmission or transmission system of the value of around 72 to 145 kilovolt lines, fine. So this is a three-phase SF6 circuit breaker that uses a special design operating mechanism with three independently controlled drive rods. So you can see there are three independent drive rods, fine. So they are basically an SF6 circuit breakers, but they need to match with the constraint which is need to be done in case of a synchronous closes. Fine, so it is able, yeah, very important thing, when we do that, and the whole procedure should take place within 1 millisecond, fine. The whole, it is capable of closing within 1 millisecond of voltage zero. So you need to do that. And what happens in order to do that, certain utilities will face a problem where continuous switching of such kind of events may cause a lot of problem into the system, because the unwanted elements or unwanted equipments may just get tripped off. Fine, so we should be very much careful about when we are doing such kind of experiments. So fine, so the actual performance of the breaker is sampled to adjust the pole timing for future operations to compensate for wear and changes in mechanical characteristics. So you can see this here, you can see these breakers, you know, the synchronous closing capacitor switches are over here. So we need to take care of that, and we need to see the sample timing with the pole timing, fine. So this figure shows a vacuum switch made for this purpose. It is applied for around 46 kilovolt class capacitor bank. So this is your capacitor bank, which is of around 46 kilovolt. It consists of three independent poles. So you can check it out. It can three independent poles. So you can use a one pole separately also. So the timing of the synchronous closing is determined by the anticipated and upcoming voltage zero. So it is success is dependent on the consistent operation of the vacuum switch. So it is completely depending on that, how successful you are when you're closing it, that is completely depend on the operation of your vacuum switch. How perfectly it has been designed and or how fast it can switch on the contact within the range specified, which we say around 1 millisecond. Fine, so the switch reduces capacitor inrush current. Fine, so what happens when you do that? So when with the contact, where it is you are able to close the contacts, it is able to limit the inrush current by an order of magnitude and voltage transients to about one per unit. Fine, so 1.1 per unit is able to reduce. So that's a huge, you know, you are not able to eliminate, but you are reducing it to a huge value, fine. So a similar switch may also be used at distribution voltage ends, fine. So this is one of the pole of the synchronous closing switch. You can see over the three poles. So if you want to view a single pole separately, that's why this figure has been given. So you can see how the a single pole looks like. So one phase of a newer type of three-phase synchronous switch used for distribution capacitor bands. So this is a new closing switch. So this particular technology uses a vacuum switch encapsulated in a solid dielectric. Fine, each of the switch describes here requires a sophisticated, yes, they required a sophisticated microprocessor control, because you know you require to bring that contact down at the time when the voltage across these breakers are zero. Fine, so a synchronous closing system is more expensive than your straightforward capacitor switch. Fine, so they are expensive, but they can be used, because if it's expensive also, but where your loads are very sensitive, fine, there we can use such kind of switching techniques. However, it is frequently a cost-effective solution when capacitor switching transients are disrupting end user loads. Fine, so when it is really becoming a very essential and it is affecting the major loads into the system, we can go for such kind of switching techniques. So this is one example which I have taken. I have just acknowledged over here from where I have taken the simulation results. So this is one of the simulation result done on the bank size of, you can see, a 20,000 kVAR three phase. And the voltage is around 115K. It's a star grounded. And to a 25 kilo ampere available fault duty, that's a short circuit current, fine. So you can see how the voltage and current behavior will get affected when you can use that zero voltage control, fine. So with the effect of these zero voltage control, how does your current and voltages are, you know, monitored on the screen, fine. So you can see the bank one energization and bank two energization, their peak current, the frequency, the peak voltage, how much peak voltage has been limited to 1.28 per unit and 1.15 per unit. Fine. So this is one practical scenario that how does your current and voltage for energization by using a zero voltage control. Fine. Next comes the capacitor locations. So, you know, it's very important. Where should I put this capacitors? Fine. So for distribution feeder banks, a switch capacitor may be too close to a sensitive loads or at a location where the transient over voltages tend to be much higher. Yes. So there are the two ways where the historical data where it says the transient, this is more prone to the transient over voltages. So we need to put the capacitors over there, capacitor banks over there, or put it across some certain very sensitive loads, fine. So it may be possible, you know, even there are chances where you can move these capacitors in your nearby branches where it is needed. So that is also a possible thing. Fine, to eliminate the problems, but if if it is very huge, then the system is very huge, then moving the location may not be such an easier job. Fine, so what we say is the strategy is to either create more damping with more resistance in the circuit or to get more impedance between the capacitor and the sensitive load. So that is what basically is the logic which we have studied in the last few slides. Fine, so the success of this strategy will depend on a number of factors. Fine, of course, if the capacitor is placed at a large load, that's what I told you. So if your capacitor is placed somewhere at the large load to the supply reactive power, then it will not be very easy, or it's not suggestible to moving the bank from one place to another place if your load is very huge. Fine, so this technique, in that case, what do you have to use? In that case, you have to use a technique of soft switching, or switching at non-critical times must be explored. So you have to think about a different technique strategies. You know, so besides utility side solutions, one should also explore load side solutions. So we also should think about what to be done in case of the load problems. So these kind of surges, we are mainly taking care of the utility end. So we should also tackle such kind of situations at the load. So we should come out with certain solutions which are very economical and can be taken care at the load end itself. So what are these solutions? So certain cost-effective solutions which have been described or explained that you can use line chokes or you can use a transient voltage surge suppressor. So TVSS, which we have discussed in our previous lecture, that is the TVSS are basically, they are located at the load end equipments. So we can use the TVSS or the line chokes to control such type of surges in the load end. Okay. Fine. So with this, we are coming at the end of complete module 2. So this is a quiz time. Let us see what are the questions we are going to face. Dash can reduce the capacitor switching transients. Yes, guys, we have just read and we have just understood what are the things which can reduce the capacitor switching transient. Yeah, so you know that pre-insertion resistors. Fine, so we can use there are two techniques which we have spoken about. Pre-insertion resistors, and the second is also there, that is called as your synchronous control circuit breakers. Fine, so popular strategy for reducing transients on capacitor switching is to use a synchronous closing circuit breakers. Fine, so this is a more popular known because this is a newer technology compared to the previous one. Fine, so the benefit of the newer technology, we know that it will take care of the high frequency component transients as well as it will damp out the transient much more faster rate. Fine. So the popular strategy for reducing transient on, I think the same slide I have done it. Fine, next one. The transformer would have to be loaded approximately 20 to 25% of resistive equivalent load to limit the ferroresonance. So I have used one quiz. I have taken or added one quiz, which is from a ferroresonance lecture. So I hope all of you remember the ferroresonance lecture and you should be able to quickly answer this question. Fine, so the transformer would have to be loaded approximately 20 to 25% of resistive equivalent load to limit ferroresonance over voltage to dash percent. Okay, so if you don't remember, then please try to recall it. So let me tell you, it is around 125%. Fine, so we have discussed in that particular lecture that how it is 125%, So utilities generally try to maintain the service voltage supplied to an end user within the dash. What is that? Utilities generally try to maintain the service voltage supplied to an end user with the plus or minus 5% of nominal. This is something not been discussed, but this is I have added for you to understand that the utility end will try to maintain the voltage because as a customer end, we should know what the variation of the voltage is allowed. Okay. So for that reason, I have added this question. So that is what it says, the plus and minus 5% of the nominal voltage is allowed at the utility end. Fine. Heated. Fine. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for listening all the 8 lectures. I hope you have enjoyed and you have learned something from these lectures. Please go through the quiz questions. These quiz questions will really help you, to score some marks and to understand the certain logic. So the quiz questions are nothing but certain tips or certain points which we should not forget. Okay. With this, thank you. Thanks once again.